Good morning, everyone. Mike Flanagan here from InsideBowling.com, joined by Matt Turek this morning for our first time here at the 2016 Southland Bowling League Championship. Matt, it's going to be an exciting day of college bowling action today here in the NCAA Women's College Bowling down here in Louisiana. I'm happy to be with you today, Matt.
Yeah, I'm happy to be here too, Mike. There's one thing about college bowling. Women's college bowling is one of the most exciting things to watch and be a part of. All the chants, all the cheers, all the excitement, the team, it's really truly a team sport. As they bowl, every time they throw the ball, whether it's a spare or strike, an open frame, a split, they are high-fiving each other. They are just, they're trying to pick each other up. It's just great camaraderie.
High-level bowling at its finest this morning here at the Southland Bowling League Championship. We have eight different schools participating, Matt.
We sure do. Starting here on lanes 9 and 10, on the left lane, starting game number one, is Monmouth University.
Monmouth University head coach Karen Greigel. She's in her sixth season, and competition's underway.
Oh, rough break.
A 4-7-9 to get started in our day. Not a good break at all, as you mentioned. And taking on Monmouth is Stephen F. Austin. They get started with a strike here on lanes 9 and 10. We'll also, a little bit later, we'll take you down to 13 and 14, where we have Sam Houston State taking on none other than Tulane University. We mentioned we had eight teams here today in a double elimination bracket. The teams represented Arkansas State Red Wolves, the Vanderbilt Commodores. They're the defending champions, Matt.
They sure are. And it's funny, they're the number two seed going into this event this year.
Also, Sam Houston State, as we mentioned, Stephen F. Austin right here in front of us taking on Monmouth, Tulane, Valparaiso, the Crusaders, and the Louisiana Tech Lady Texters. So we will have action all day here for you on InsideBowling.com. Also want to thank Chris McCoskey, the Assistant Commissioner of Television and Electronic Media for the Southern Bowling Conference, for allowing us to be here today. This is a best of seven match
Baker format
in the four different matches that we have going on here, from AMF All-Star Lanes here in Kenner, Louisiana. Baker format, that's right, Matt.
It's one of my favorite formats in bowling. It really makes you be a team, and a lot of people don't get the opportunity to actually bowl Baker style, and if you do or you have the opportunity, I would definitely take it. It's a lot of fun.
Wow, what a break there. That's got to feel good early in the morning to get started with a strike like that. So
Stephen F. Austin off to a good start.
Yeah, they sure are. They're clean through three frames with the split conversion also.
Let's see if Monmouth can answer right back here in the third frame. Makes a good shot.
And that's Jessica Nanneman. She's the third bowler today. All the ladies actually have a number assigned here in the NCAA competition.
That's right.
I'm not sure how they arrive at their numbers, but Jessica Nanneman, she is number four. Across from her right now for Stephen F. Austin, bowling fourth, is Paige Krauschar.
Paige has a 195 average this year so far for 43 games. She's competed in seven events this year out on the college circuit.
And an open frame for her. Early in the morning, you know, I don't know, it's been a long time since I bowled college, Matt, but I might be a little nerves to get started in the day. It's a double elimination match play bracket. Today's oil pattern is 40 feet, 24.8 milliliters of oil. It's a 2.3-1, pretty flat ratio.
True sports shot.
And they are bowling on AMF HPL lanes for you tech junkies out there that are interested in those sorts of things. We want to welcome in all of our viewers that are watching right now on YouTube. Once again, this is the best of seven match. The first team to win four games will advance in the bracket. If you'd like to see the bracket down below, you can, if you're on insidebowling.tv, on our event information tab down below, you'll be able to view the bracket and you'll be able to pay attention at home and keep up with what's going on and fill out your own bracket today.
Yeah, follow along with all the great bowling as your favorite team advances through the bracket.
I will tell you that the entire team here that's participating in running the event, Rick Barbera is here, who I've known for a very long time. And also here, Melissa Siebold, the Assistant Director of Communications, and Stephanie McDonald, the Associate Commissioner of Institutional Services, also here. They've provided us with a lot of stats
A
lot of paperwork to help
us
out here today. So we're going to give you as much information as we can throughout the day, as it's been a little while since we've brought college bowling to people's living rooms.
Monmouth with a strike up in the fifth. They're looking to get this game turned around real quick here, as Stephen F. Austin has kind of fell off the wagon. They were on a good pace to start the game. Had a nine count whiff as Monmouth strikes there in the sixth, give them a double, putting them back into the match.
As we mentioned, we did say that we do have another pair here. We'll take you over there now, lanes 13 and 14.
Here on lane 13, you see Sam Houston State University. The Bearcats, as they're called. They're taking on Tulane University, the Green Wave.
And I'll tell you what, lanes 13 and 14 looks pretty high scoring, Matt.
It's so far, so good. Sam Houston started out with the first five strikes. And they're clean through eight frames. Tulane is trying to stay with them in game one of this match.
For Tulane, Angela Faugost up, trying to pick the 10 pin. And she covers it up, so still clean. And we can see if Anna Groach can go up here and convert the bucket minus the eight.
Covers it up nicely.
So a possible max score of 237 for Tulane.
Tulane there with a big strike, boy. They're excited. They got a lot of big cheering section here. Tulane, I believe, from the area.
Possible 244 for Sam Houston. Anchor bowler Heather Panatzer leaving the bucket. So we've seen two light hits on lane 13 now out of the fourth and fifth bowlers for Sam Houston State. Possible 230 left if she spares strikes, so a double and a tenth here for Tulane.
That'll
get
be
her
huge.
Done.
There's, oh wow, wobble seven.
Pretty good shot there out of Michelle Ng. So with just a couple of pins here, Sam Houston State's gonna go up 1-0. Uh-oh. That's going to be enough, I believe. Action fast, action furious this morning. 219, yeah, it is enough. Best they can bowl is 217 for Tulane. So we will take you back over to lanes 9 and 10. Stephen F. Austin and Monmouth.
Stephen F. Austin finishing game one with a 2-0-3 game, and it looks like they're going to take the win by 10 pins here with a double if Monmouth strikes out. They get the second one in the 10th. That gives them a turkey. Bowlers on 9 and 10 now switching lanes. In the Baker format, teams will bowl a single game on one lane and then switch after each game, alternating lanes back and forth. Here on 9 and 10, Stephen F. Austin is up one game to 0 on Monmouth. First team to win 4 games will win the match and advance along into the bracket.
Take you back over to lanes 13 and 14.
Tulane now on the left lane 13. Starting off strong. They had a double to start the game, and they were getting really, really excited. Angela up now, lefty 6'10". And covers it nicely. Keeping them clean. Nasty split there for Tulane in the fourth. Danyan Terry here. She had a 180 average this season. She bowled in 26 games through 6 events. Recapping some of the other games on our off-camera pairs, Arkansas State, ranked number 1 coming into this event, took on number 8, Louisiana Tech. Arkansas State won the first match, so they are up 1-0 in the best of 7 match. At the bottom of the bracket, number 2, Vanderbilt, took on number 7, Valpo. Vanderbilt took the win in game 1, and they are up 1-0. Thank you. Tough break there on the 10 for Sam Houston. Heather had a 204 average this year through 51 games, 8 events. She had one top 1 finish individually and 2 top 5 finishes this year individually. Michelle Nigg spared up the 1-2 on lane 13 for Tulane. Michelle averaged 202 this season through 42 games and 7 events, had 1 top 1 finish and 2 top 5 finishes individually this year. Hannah Harrison there with the washout for Tulane. Here's Stephanie for Sam Houston up on the right. Stephanie averaged 186 through 27 games, and she strikes them up there.
Yeah, looked really good out there, Matt. She is looking good. Sam Houston stayed up 1-0 over Tulane. Best of 7 match. Happy you're with us here this morning. We do have some folks here in the chat. Want to say hello to Sean Davis, Hunter Hartley here this morning watching. Looks like this pair is starting to break down a little bit.
A little bit,
Matt.
Yeah.
Both players on each team have both left the 4-7. Oil pattern starting to dry up a little bit. We'll take you back over to lanes 9 and 10, and we'll check in. On Stephen F. Austin and Monmouth University.
Maria for Monmouth. Mariah averaged 179 through 21 games and 5 events this year.
Mariah Jacobson. You know, there was a golfer, Matt, named Peter Jacobson back in the day. He used to be one of my favorite golfers.
Yeah, he's actually the voice on Golden Tee, if I do recall.
Yeah, but you're right. Might it be? Yeah, I think, yeah.
He's like the Randy Peterson of golf.
I think so. I don't know if there's a relation.
No, but
if anybody's watching, they
with
can,
his quirks.
Yeah,
type it into the chat if he's related or not. So this match, a little bit slower paced than the other. Monmouth spares it up in the 7th. Giving them 114 in the 6th. They have a lead on Stephen F. Austin. This is game 2 of a best-of-7 match.
And as you mentioned, Matt, a little quicker pace of play down on 13 and 14 as this match is going to, game number 2 of this match is going to end first on our 2 featured pairs. A suburb of New Orleans, Kenner, Louisiana is where we are. AMF All-Star Lanes. This is a big bowling center,
Matt. It is.
Matt.
They've sectioned off half of it quite nicely.
Have. Sam Houston State up 1-0. Looking like they are going to go up 2-0.
It does. Heather here in the 10th frame struck. First ball of the 10th. She's now up again looking for a double. double here will make this match all but over. There's Michelle Nigg from Tulane. Michelle, top bowler on the team, 202 average for 42 games, 7 events, 1 top 1 finish, and 2 top 5 finishes individually. Here's Heather now. Actually, it's Michelle. She gonna roll that 10, roll that beautiful beam footage, rolls that 10 straight out of the deck into the pit for a double for Tulane. They have a max score of 172. Heather goes up, leaves the 6-10. She left the 6-10 in the fill ball for
193.
193. So they are going to take game number two. Sam Houston, 2-0 lead on Tulane. Back down to 9-10 here. We see Stephen F. Austin and Monmouth.
Monmouth's going to even the score here. It's going to be 1-1 after two games.
Stephanie Schwartz here for Stephen F. Austin, throwing her fill ball for a 153 game. That's a game they would like to forget and bounce back. They are going to switch lanes to their good lane where they won the first game as Monmouth takes game number two.
Back over to lanes 13 and 14 now, getting going. Game number three here for Sam Houston State. And the touch on the 10 pin for Stephanie Zavala. Now up for Tulane. Leadoff bowler Hannah Harrison comes in light, leaves the 1-2-4. Really important for Tulane to get it going here now. Down 2-0 early in this best of seven match. Matt back here now, and Matt, I was just mentioning that it's really important now for Tulane to get on the board and get a point up there. You know, with Sam Houston State up 2-0, to fall 3-0, you'd have to win 4 in a row. This is a real pivotal game here in this match. Best of 7, double elimination match play bracket. And now we've seen Tulane miss the head pin to the right twice in a row. Sam Houston State looking to pounce here up in the third frame. Carrie Hopkinson comes in high, leaves the 3-6.
In other matches, Vanderbilt, number two, took game number two against Valpo, and we're still waiting for Louisiana Tech and Arkansas State to finish. Looks like Louisiana State actually just finished, took the game number two, so that series is tied one game apiece. This best of seven match. Tulane's getting some fire on our other feature pair. Monmouth, though, starting out, strikes fair in game number three.
What a good-looking shot right there. By Anna Grochi. A lot of really good, talented female bowlers here. I'll tell you what, the future is bright in the sport of bowling. So we'll stay here because our Stephen F. Austin Monmouth match is 1-1, and this 2-0
Sam Houston
State versus Tulane. This is really
that's a pivotal game.
Look
three.
At that. Look at the light hit. I don't know what came over and took out the 10 pin, but.
Yeah, Michelle likes it. She's not going to complain.
Their head coach, Brad Hagan, I've known Brad for a while. Such a good guy. He's down there really enjoying the coaching. I talked to him earlier today, and he said he wouldn't rather be doing anything else than coaching college bowling.
Here's Hannah Harrison now back up in the sixth for Stephen Sam Houston. Nope. I apologize. That's Stephanie Zavala, and she strikes, giving her team a turkey. Stephanie averaged 186 this year with 27 games through seven events.
Sam Houston State, out of the eight teams here, is the 3 seed. Tulane, the number 6 seed. Tulane, of course, one of the coolest names, in my opinion, in the field, the Green Wave.
That's right, Mike. The Green Wave.
Sam Houston State, of course, being the Bearcats. So Tulane answers in the sixth, and now a possible open frame here. Not an easy spare to convert for Sam Houston State, but covers it.
Oh, wow, nice cover. Keeping them alive. Madison Keller spared that up.
For Tulane, Haley Veach is their head coach, and her husband Justin, an accomplished bowler as well. We run a tournament in St. Louis called the InsideBowling.com Open, and Justin finished 6th, just outside of the top 5, 3 years ago in that event. Really had a chance to get to know him, and I know he and Haley are just absolutely in love with bowling, and they dedicate all their time to bowling, Haley being the head coach for Tulane. It's cool to see people involved with bowling, all the way from husbands, wives, daughters, sons, grandmas, grandpas. Speaking of which, I'm sure we've got plenty of parents watching here today. Welcome into our broadcast again. Mike Flanagan here with you, along with Matt Turek.
Hello.
Here at the 2016 Southland Bowling League Championship. We are in Louisiana, a suburb of New Orleans, here in Kenner, Texas. Kenner, Louisiana, excuse me. So a possible max score of 220 for Sam Houston State. Oh, that was a really good-looking shot right there by Tulane. So now Tulane, a possible max score of just 209. So it's going to be important for Tulane to throw a triple somewhere in here to finish out the match. this game of the match. Uh-oh. Sam Houston State comes in light, 2-4-10. So now without a spare here, the best Sam Houston State can bowl is in the 190s. And Tulane's going at a 189 pace.
We have a max score alert, 247 game down on lane number 5.
And that's for Arkansas State.
They are the number one seed as the Louisiana Tech Lady Texters answer right back with a strike of their own down on the other pair, 5 and 6.
We're glad you're with us today watching live coverage here on InsideBowling.com. What a great shot right there in the ninth frame, setting it up for the 10th frame for Tulane. As we mentioned, this is a pivotal game here. It's
very important game, Mike.
So now possible 209 for Tulane, possible 199 for Sam Houston State. Heather Pentenzer. Leaves the 10, so can only bowl 189.
Heather averaged 204 this year.
Strike here wins it. Oh, what a
Michelle.
Did it. Oh, what a bad break. A pocket six pin. Unbelievable. So now needs to spare here. We have a possibility of a tie, Matt. If Sam Houston State can fill it up here, it'll be 189. And with a spare strike for Tulane, it'll be 189 as well.
Now, do they do roll-offs in the event of
a
tie?
No, they each get a half.
Well, they get half a point.
They do. Which will make things interesting for our graphics.
Yes.
That's okay. See Coach Hagen there?
Yeah.
And it'll be interesting to see if they're going to wait before they throw this ball or if they're going to apply the pressure. They're taking a re-rack. So a re-rack now for Sam Houston State. I see that on TV on the professional tour. And now I believe it's probably 2 re-racks a game, I would imagine.
Yeah, so quick update on 5 and 6 off camera. Arkansas State beat the Louisiana Tech Lady Texters by 2 pins, 227 to 225 that game. That was a very close match. Arkansas State goes up 2-1.
Louisiana Tech with a win down there,
as you mentioned
earlier. So Louisiana Tech, the 8th seed. For them to, if they were to knock off Arkansas State, that would be unbelievable. So,
yeah, that would be the upset alert of the weekend.
But
probably.
Once again, it is 2-1 right now, Arkansas State down in that match.
And we should remind everybody this is double elimination bracket. So each team has got to lose twice to be eliminated from the tournament. So, as Sam Houston finishes their 189
out. Yeah, that strike was huge right there.
Yes, it was.
That's 189, so they're guaranteed at least a tie. At least a tie. So Tulane needs them all for a tie.
Is Michelle Nigg up in the 10th frame?
I believe it's Ing.
Ing?
Yeah.
My apologies. Looks pretty good.
And we do.
Boy.
We have a tie.
What a game. What a game. Boy, the fans here are really supporting Tulane from the Louisiana area, New Orleans area. They have videographers here, photographers here. The fans are really behind them, and they're voicing it right now.
Thank you. So there's our updated graphic. 2.5 to a half right now.
So
which basically means that game didn't count. It's the best way to put that. It's just kind of a null match.
Yeah, that's a little confusing. Hannah Harrison for Tulane up there leaving the 3-pin. And misses it, but still getting the high fives from her team. Nasty washout split, 1-2-8-10 there for Sam Houston. That was Madison Keller. Madison Keller averaged 192 through six events this year.
Okay, Matt, we'll take you back over to lanes 9 and 10 where we pick up Stephen F. Austin up 2-1 over Monmouth University. Looks like we got a deadwood in front of the is it going to make it around? Oh, look at that.
Took out the head pin.
You don't see that very often.
No, you don't.
You really don't. You don't see just the head pin taken out by a deadwood moving in front of the rake.
That's right, you don't.
I don't know if I've ever seen that, actually.
Got a quick update now on the other televised pair. Valpo upsets Vanderbilt in game number 3, 179-169. Vanderbilt now with a 2-game-to-1 lead. Tulane is back in the driver's seat with a strike up in the board in the third frame.
Down over on lanes 13 and 14. We give a shout out to Sheridan Lanes watching right now. Cheering for Stephen F. Austin.
Stephen F. Austin, not too shabby of a college bowling program. They had 47 top 10 appearances in tournaments since 2009. And right now, you're watching Carly Larson for Stephen F. Austin.
Lanes are going through transition now, Matt. That's what I see out on the lanes, because you're seeing a mixture of light hits and high hits on the pocket. So as the oil gets used up and changes around, you know, all these ladies use plastic spare balls going cross lane. You'll see some of the oil carry down, which will cause for, with only 2 shots a game per bowler, with the leadoff bowler bowling the first and the sixth frame, the second bowler bowling the second and the seventh, the third and the eighth, the fourth and the ninth, and then, of course, the anchor bowler bowling the fifth and the entire 10th frame here in this Baker format, it's going to sometimes play tricks on you. And that's where the spare game is so important in college bowling. We'll be bringing you action all day today, folks. We have matches planned out throughout the entire day.
We do 4 rounds of action.
We have a total of 14 matches that we'll be bringing to you today. Right now, currently matches 1 through 4. Arkansas State against Louisiana Tech, and Arkansas State's up 2-1 in that match. Stephen F. Austin and Monmouth right here, 2-1. You see Stephen F. Austin with the lead.
Sam Houston State and Tulane, 2.5 to 1/2 after that tie game. And Valpo is up on Vanderbilt, 2-1. Welcome Jonathan Bayer in the chat there. Looks like a future college bowler. It's exciting, and if you have the opportunity, Jonathan, to do it, I would definitely take it. It's one of the most fun experiences of your life, and you will never forget it. I promise you that. There with a nice little string. They started out rough, but now they've righted the ship.
Yep. That's what a couple of strikes can do for you, Matt. Ever so quickly, you can get right back in a match.
That's right.
But I'll tell you what, I like what Stephen F. Austin's doing here. They're just staying nice and clean, and I say that, and it was the kiss of death right there.
Yep.
Crossing over. You know, that wasn't a good shot, but that's a bad break when you think of 5-10.
It was a bad break.
So 106 in the sixth currently right now for Stephen F. Austin. 115 in the sixth for Monmouth. A couple of frames ahead of Stephen F. Austin. What a great looking shot right there.
That was a great shot. Very good shot from Kara Grant. Miss Grant averaged 188 this year for 15 games across 3 events.
This match a little bit behind the Sam Houston State Tulane match. So we'll take you down there currently, and we'll check in and see what's happening there. Tulane in a little bit of trouble here this game. Tulane with a max score of only 184. Sam Houston State is going at a 207 pace. So Sam Houston State.
Here's Danian Terry now up for Tulane. That looks like a good shot. Coming in a little high with the four pin. Start of the 10th frame for Sam Houston. And they carry 10 back. Thank you. Heather Pencer for Sam Houston in the 10th. Left that flat 10. Oh, Michelle with a lucky break there for Tulane, rolling the 6 into the 3 for a strike. Still will not be enough to beat Sam Houston in this game. We have another update down on 5 and 6 where we have the number 1 seed, Arkansas State. They beat the Louisiana Tech Lady Texters 204-184, giving Arkansas State a 3-1 lead in their match. Show there with a 10.
So Tulane, I think that they're going to sub somebody in, or they're looking to do something here. Sam Houston State's going to go up 3.5 to 1/2. We'll go back down to Stephen F. Austin and Monmouth. Monmouth gets the win here, which is going to settle the score and make it even 2-2. So it'll be a best of three match, basically, on lanes 9 and 10.
Question for you, Mike. Over in Sam Houston versus Tulane, if they tie again, Sam Houston will advance.
Yes,
is
they will.
Is that correct?
Yep. It's the first person I figured it out, Matt. That's what I got up and I was asking earlier when I left the booth for a moment was they have to get four. I mean, you
four,
have to
yeah.
get to four.
Yeah. However you
somehow.
Get there.
Yeah, exactly.
Ties will count. That's why every pin counts in an event like this. Do not want to give pins away.
So we got our updated graphic here, 2-2. And no action on either pair right now.
Stephen F. and Monmouth are about to get underway.
Yep, and we'll stay here with them. We're glad you're with us, like we've been saying all day long, 2016 Southland Bowling League Championship. I'm Mike Flanagan, joined by Matt Turek here this morning where the action is fast and furious. We have four matches going on of the eight teams here at that make up the Southland Bowling League. This is their championship event. Double elimination match play, Baker format.
Danielle Lynn there for Stephen F. Austin with an opening strike.
Also here in the chat, want to give a shout out to Jonathan Bayer watching and Sheridan Lanes. Got some Stephen F. Austin fans, and we've got quite the match here with Stephen F. Austin.
We sure do, Mike. Tied two games each, best of three now.
And we knew this was going to be probably the best match out there. That's why we have it on your live stream, the 4 and 5 seeds, just like March Madness going on right now,
That's right.
The men's NCAA tournament, which is so popular. You know, those 8 and 9 seed matchups, you really don't know who to ever pick. And that's exactly what we have here right now with Stephen F. Austin and Monmouth.
An update from the other pair, or the other match going on. Valpo, 216 over Vanderbilt, 205.
Uh-oh.
So that means that's 3-1 in that match against that's upset alert, guys, ladies and gentlemen. Upset alert, number 7,
and
Valpo.
And that's confirmed, huh? Valpo's up 3-1 over Vanderbilt. Wow. Battle of the V's.
Yeah.
That's why I wanted to make sure it was right. They both have the same name, but it starts with a V. Wow.
That is definitely an upset alert. Vanderbilt defending champions.
Vanderbilt being the 2 seed against 7 seed Valparaiso. Monmouth off to a bad start here in game number 5. Trying to get on the board here. Oh, and a solid 8.
Wow.
Can't throw it any better than that. This is not a very easy spare makeup here with a 6 count. The bucket minus the 9, but we'll add the 10, have you. That covers,
covers
it up.
It up
no
nicely.
Problem at all.
Really nice spare there for Carly Larson.
And you leave that when you come in really light on the head pin. And that means the ball's not quite getting high enough onto the head pin to knock them all down.
Valerie Bermudez here for Monmouth is up next after Jessica goes for her smash 8-pin.
Our other match we've been keeping an eye on, Sam Houston State and Tulane right now. They're in the 4th frame and pretty even right now with both teams clean. We'll move down there as the match progresses. I tell you, they really did a nice job with all the signage and everything in here.
They sure did.
You know, once again, a shout out to Melissa Siebold and Stephanie McDonald and all their great work. And I know they've got a team of people working here, part of the Southern Bowling League. Hats off to them for putting on this event. They got the trophies are really, really cool too. We'll get a shot of them tomorrow when we do the presentation. We'll be bringing you coverage today till about 5:30 this evening, where we will have these 4 matches, and then matches 5 and 6 will come up a little bit later, and then 7 and 8. We'll also bring you 9 and 10, 11 and 12, and then tomorrow we'll bring you a match 13 and 14, and we'll crown a champion beginning at 9:30 a.m. tomorrow morning.
And if you want to check out who is which matches at about what time and who they're going to be facing, you can take a look at the bracket on the event information tab. It's the blue button below the live stream window. Click on the blue button, click manual refresh, you'll be able to see the bracket and check it all out for yourself. Stephanie Schwartz there with a nasty. It was a challenging spare conversion there. Keeping them clean for Stephen F. Austin. As they have a little bit of a lead. About 18 pins or so on Monmouth.
Want to say hello to Brad G, watching from Australia.
Good day, mate.
That's right.
Got a little shrimp on the barbie.
I was gonna go there. Love Australia.
Yep, the land down under.
Brad G probably has seen Jason Belmonte and Sam Cooley bowl. Two of the best bowlers to come from Australia. Ooh, and almost gave that a run there, like the split. Now we're starting to see splits, Matt.
Yep, that's the transition. They're going to run into a little bit of over-under with their reaction until they open up a little bit, I would imagine.
Close match here. We will move you now down to lanes 13 and 14. Sam Houston State looking to close out the match. Up 3.5 games to 1/2. The half signifying a tie. 2 games ago, they tied at 189. Both bowlers on the last shot of the game, both delivered a strike. The 4th and 5th seeds over on 9 and 10. Stephen F. Austin and Monmouth University. Tulane University, the 6 seed. Sam Houston State, the 3 seed. Wow, netball just didn't get back. So Tulane in big trouble here. Sam Houston State looking really good to advance.
So I do want to make a correction here, Mike.
Yeah?
We did confirm down at the match of the V's, and it is tied 2-2.
Oh, it's tied 2-2.
So my apologies there.
Okay, 2-2 down in that match. Glad we got that confirmed. Our field reporter can run down there at any given time and just tap on anybody's shoulder, and that's not a problem. Mi casa, su casa. So possible 195 max score for Tulane. And
Anna Gross just covered up the spare there for Sam Houston.
Yeah, and that's going to just about lock up this match. I mean, it's still mathematically possible, but without a strike here on 14, they need a strike to stay alive. Got it. Just as I say that, gets a strike.
Exciting match update from the number one seed, Arkansas State. Lady Texters of Louisiana Tech, 184 over Arkansas State, your number one seed, 172. That match, Arkansas State has a 3-2 lead.
Okay. Possible upset. So this isn't over yet. Got to have a strike here in the ninth for Tulane. Comes in light, leaves the two pin, and it's all but over now for Tulane. They will go to the losers part of the bracket. They're not out of the tournament, but this particular match, Sam Houston State gets the W, and it was fun watching these two teams. Of course, they're both going to bowl some more for us here today, but take you back down to where the action is happening now, lanes 9 and 10, and we'll remain here for the rest of our opening round here from the 2016 Southland Bowling League Championship. All tied up, 2 games apiece, Stephen F. Austin and Monmouth, but not for long. Monmouth is going to lose. Stephen F. Austin is going to take a 3-2 lead of this best of 7. Thank you. Okay. Getting some housekeeping done here. Stephen F. Austin up 3-2. So, if anything unfolds like it should here, Monmouth here is going to go up and win this game to force a game seven, and it'll be down to a one-game match. That's what I predict, Matt.
I think that'd be very exciting. I'd like to see that.
I'll tell you the other thing, that now that we're just focusing on one match as Sam Houston State closes out Tulane, and this is our pair now, just talking out loud with you here on the air as we've had so many different things moving, is it that the, you know, we've had five games, so Stephen F. Austin just won on the right lane. Has this gone back and forth each game? Because the reason why I ask that is, has every game been won on the right lane?
That's a very good observation. I cannot confirm.
I'm going to find that out.
That would be very interesting to know, though. Daniel Lynn for Stephen F. Austin there with a strike to start the game. And Julie Bianco with the 10-pin for Monmouth. Got a quick update of the Battle of the V's. Vanderbilt 178 over Valpo 105. Vanderbilt takes a 3-2 lead over Valpo.
Yeah, hey, every game that has been won on this lane's 9-10.
Yeah.
Every time a team has won, it's been on the right lane.
Oh, nice. That's a good observation there. That's a hot take. If I do believe. There's Mariah Jacobson with a nice strike. Very nice strike for Monmouth. Coming in a little light. Here's Carly Larson. Stephen F. Austin coming in high, 6'10".
Yeah, that Vanderbilt match, Matt, as I'm roaming now, it's 3-2 Vanderbilt, as you said, and they're just underway in the first frame. Of game six. Uh-oh.
Well, that was a chop there for Carly.
You know, we talk about this right lane being the one that they win on, and that is one every game, but you got to make spares to have a chance on the left lane.
That's very, very true.
But easier said than done. Easy to do from up here in the commentator's booth. The one really great thing that I pick up here as we've been broadcasting for a little over an hour here is just the amount of camaraderie, as you said, to open up the broadcast, Matt, but the amount of support from parents and spectators coming out to watch today and support these ladies. It's unprecedented.
Yeah, it's really cool to see all the parents and probably friends of the players here, especially from Tulane, being the local college. They have a big big outcry of supporters here. There's bleachers that are just about full behind the lanes of parents and spectators.
Don't forget, we do have a chat. We are broadcasting on YouTube today. I want to give a shout-out to Marcel Marins, who's watching, and also to Nick Pate, who is watching this awesome stream, as Nick says, with Aaron McCarthy. And we streamed the Fusion Realtors a few weeks ago. And Nick Pate was bowling, and Aaron McCarthy and Diana.
They had a pizza party,
Queen Diana, yeah, they had a pizza party.
Yeah, a pizza party was pretty fun.
You can go watch that archive on our YouTube channel at a later date, or maybe this evening, if today's not enough bowling action for you.
Yeah.
Crossing over for a strike.
It was a Caitlin. It was. It was Caitlin Reif. Ref. Caitlin Reif. Caitlin Reif, 196 average this year for 37 games across six events, had one top five individual finish. Danielle Lynn for Stephen F. Austin. Now up in the sixth. Got that one really far wide. Misses the headpin for the old 189, Mike. The 189 leave.
Also shout out to Thomas Berman watching right now as well. Hello, Thomas. Thanks for watching. It's been a good start to the day here, Matt.
Yeah, it has.
Just when we get our stream figured out, too, is when the action will begin to digress. It's always the most action in a double elimination bracket right out of the gate. There's the most matches going on, the most things moving around. Players are trying to get used to the lanes, trying to get used to the layout here of the land, so to speak. The tournament organizers are making sure everything's working properly, and now everybody's in a groove. And I expect to see some scores go up here, especially.
I think so, too. I think once they open up a little bit more.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, and there's less over-under, and bowlers can all play off of the same spot, then I think scores are really going to go up.
You know, somebody told me one day, too, Matt, one of the best words of advice I've ever gotten, or words of wisdom, I should say, is a trend is your friend. And we are seeing the continuing of a trend on lane 10 right now. As lane 10 gets the W every time currently. Stephen F. Austin up 3-2 in his best of seven match. Monmouth up on the right lane. And Monmouth is in the lead by 23 pins.
Update now on our lanes 5 and 6. Arkansas State beat Louisiana Tech Lady Texters 4-2. They advance to take on the winner of the match we're watching right here between Stephen F. Austin and Monmouth.
And that's going to be what some people might call a barn burner, what some people might call just a really great contested match between a couple of ladies' teams. We're looking for drama today, folks. That's what we're looking for. We're looking for close matches. And speaking of close matches, now an opening for Stephen F. Austin, but an open in the seventh for both teams. It's a 23-pin match with three frames to go. Stephen F. Austin up 3-2. If they could win this game, they would close out the match. Monmouth trying to stay alive. Must win this game and the next game to advance in the winner's bracket.
It's Jessica Nanaman for Monmouth. Up in the eighth frame. Strike here will go a long way. She crosses up high, leaving a three.
Fortunate just to leave that three pin.
Yeah, very fortunate. Here's Carly with her six-pin attempt.
Carly Larson says, I got it this time. We saw her earlier miss the six and only took the 10 off the 6-10. So covers it with no problem on that shot. This is an easy spare. This is 98%.
I would tend to agree with you. Straight
flatten
up the gut.
Out the wrist.
Yep, she knows it.
Straight
she picked
at it
with no problem.
So possible 207 now for Monmouth. 184, Stephen F. Austin.
There's a big strike there from Page. Big strike for Page. And we'll see if Valerie Bermudez can answer right back. And keep their lead over Stephen F. Austin. And they got it.
Sure did. So 187 pace right now for Monmouth. And Stephen F. Austin can strike out for 184, but must double. Oh, that was a great shot. Leaves the seven. And now Monmouth having a little discussion on whether or not they want to maybe see if they want to try a different ball, sub a player in, all the different things that can happen. A lot of the teams bring 8-9 girls here, and they could sub in and out at any given time.
I love the chance. So, yeah, if Monmouth can strike, they might have this game in hand, and it'll
They do have it. It's over. We're going to a game seven, Matt. Caitlin Reth, I'm really impressed with her game. Had an opportunity to watch her now through. Now this is the sixth game, anchor bowler, and she gets the job done here in the 10th frame. We're going to what they call the rubber match. Game number seven, it's 3-3. Get our graphic updated here.
It's getting exciting down in that Valpo and Vanderbilt match.
I'm going mobile, Matt.
Going rogue as bowlers are switching pairs here for game seven. Match number two in the first round here at the 2016 Southland Bowling League Championships here at All-Star Lanes in Kenner, Louisiana.
Hey, it's going to go to a game seven down here on 17 and 18, Matt. Valparaiso right now. Up in the 10th frame, must get one pin of the baby split. Left the anchor bowler left a 310. Must get one pin here because all that Vanderbilt was able to muster up was 166. So must get one pin. Looks like they got it.
Yep.
And
so that's a game seven too.
Actually, Matt, my math was off. They tied.
They tied?
Yes, it was a tie.
Wow.
Which is the same as a win or a loss. It means it does come down to game seven.
That's true. Monmouth starts out with a clutch strike there. Clutch strike for Julie Bianco.
Yeah, Rick Barbera just confirmed down on 17 and 18 that it is going to come down to a game number seven between Vanderbilt and Valparaiso. I'll tell you what we'll do, folks. If we have an opportunity, we will take the wireless camera down there and get you some bonus coverage. But currently right now, we've got a great match here going to game number seven on 9 and 10.
Tough break there for Stephen F. Austin. Danielle Lynn with the 5-7. Another split though left for Monmouth. Mariah Jacobson.
Okay. Back with you here. I'm back in the booth with Matt. It's just on rogue assignment there. trying to get you some bonus coverage here today. 17 and 18, Valparaiso, Vanderbilt down there, 3-3 in their match. Right here, going to a game seven as well. You've been watching it here live all morning. Stephen F. Austin, Monmouth University, 3-3. The right lane has won every single game in this match. Lane number 10 is the trend. Be interesting to see.
Great shot.
If Monmouth can overcome lane 9
Wow.
to advance, that would be something.
Great shot there from Miss Grant. Big strike there, giving them a nice start. That was Carly Larson. Carly Larson, for Stephen F. Austin. I can't come up with any more rhyming words. You see a tough break there, coming a little high for Monmouth, leaving the six pin. Here's Paige Krauschar, leaving that 10. They're off to a nice start here. Stephen F. Austin through 3.5 frames. Jessica now up on the left lane, gets the strike. Staying in the match. Here's the anchor bowler now for Stephen F. Austin, Stephanie Schwartz. Leaving the 2-5. Caitlin Reff now up for Monmouth. Tough break there. Coming back around here, Danielle Lynn. Stephen F. Austin leaving the 2-4-8 there. Julie. Julie with the 10 pin. Not too bad of a spare. Very important, though. They are
it's not too close.
Far behind, yeah.
Yeah, it's still very close here.
Bianco going for her 10 pin. Be a very important spare for the team, and she covers it up perfectly. K. Kara Grant now up in the seventh frame for Stephen F. Austin. A strike here will really put him up on top as she gets it. And here we got a little bonus coverage here of the Battle of the V's down on 17 and 18. Valpo there with a big strike. This is a game seven match.
Yeah, and currently down here, possible 245 for Vanderbilt. Valparaiso, possible 290 max score here.
That is a tough break for Vanderbilt.
Valpo is rolling up in the eighth frame now. Max score, 290.
Coming a little light, not too bad of a shot. Maybe a little firm with it, a little hard.
Bonus coverage down here. So possible 221 left for Vanderbilt. Valpo is already in the... Valpo is just going to have to basically stay clean the rest of the game, and they're going to defeat Vanderbilt and get the upset.
Wow. We're going to keep it here. Down in our other match, Stephen F. Austin has 134 in the seventh, a spare up in the eighth. Monmouth has 112 in the seventh with a strike up in the eighth. Stephen F. Austin just struck in the ninth. That's really giving them a lead.
Hey, Matt, Valpo's going to get the W. It's official.
All right, well, there you have it, the upset. We'll take you back down here to 9 and 10. The upset, Valparaiso.
Okay, Matt, so down there in that Valpo match, I just found out exactly what's going to happen because of that tie. They're going to bowl a half a game, I was told.
Yeah, because it was 3.5 Vanderbilt to 2.5 Valparaiso.
So they're going to have some sort of bonus bowl off. This is our first time, so we'll keep you posted on exactly what happens. We were told it will be a half game. Every bowler will bowl once.
So Monmouth here is going to be defeated. They have a max score of 182. Stephen F. Austin shot 202. So Stephen F. Austin, your number four seed, will go on to take on number one Arkansas State in the next round. We will have that match for you on 13 and 14.
So kind of crazy that on this pair 9 and 10 that lane 10 got the win every time.
That means over in the contenders bracket, Monmouth will take on Louisiana Tech.
There you have it. Stephen F. Austin defeats Monmouth 4-3. So now I'm going to try to get coverage of this other
this half a game match to determine the winner.
See what I can do here. Okay, bear with me, folks. I've got the wireless camera here for these five frames. There you see Rick Barbera dressed in his suit today.
Looking sharp.
Rick is one of the all-time good guys in bowling. He's part of the Brunswick management team for many, many years, training all the general managers. Now he works on the scoring side of the Brunswick business. And if you're just joining us, Valparaiso and Vanderbilt are tied at 3.5 each. And they're going to bowl a half game, as it's been reported to us. If you look up here at the score monitors, they've got zeros in through five frames. So it will be the 6th through 10th frames here. Lane 17 and 18 here at AMF All-Star Lanes, and we're getting going right now.
Boy, Valpo is really on fire right now. They won the last game to push it to this bonus coverage, and they are just hot. They are not backing down from this challenge.
Brian Valenta and Gabrielle Mayfield are actually here. They are involved with Valpo, assistant coaches.
Valpo with a double. Trying to answer right back.
Now keep in mind, this is your 2 seed versus your 7 seed.
Yeah. Coming in a little high there. Baby split. Valpo finished 3rd last year in the Southland Bowling League Championship. As Vanderbilt answers with a strike. What's the score, lay of the land on the scoreboard down there, Mike?
Spare double for Vanderbilt. Valpo double. And this baby split.
Tough break there.
So now Vanderbilt with a big opportunity here for a triple.
Hard spare, one of the easiest, as you mentioned earlier, 98% you'd like to think on this spare. Oh, wow, what a break.
Oh, what
Valpo.
A break. You're
Holy
right, Matt.
Cow.
You called it perfect right there.
Unbelievable. So, Valpo, double open strike. Vanderbilt, spare, double three pin.
Yep, that's a three pin. For those of you that are watching at home, Matt is down by lanes 9 and 10. I'm down here by 17 and 18, holding the wireless camera, bringing you a little bonus coverage. We want to bring you all the coverage that we possibly can here from this great event.
So now it's the 10th frame.
And Valpo's going to be up first in the 10th frame, working on a strike. Pretty good shot. Comes in a little high. Could have left a 4-9. Just leaves the 9. And now Vanderbilt with a strike here can pretty much close it out.
Good shot. Good shot for Vanderbilt. Valpo covers the spare, but that's not going to be enough, is it, Mike?
Well, 96 possible for Valpo. And yes, it's not enough. Vanderbilt already with 99.
Okay.
So Vanderbilt, they dodge a bullet.
They sure did.
But what an effort from Valpo. Valpo is going to be interesting to watch in the loser's bracket.
Watch this last shot here as coverage winds down from round number one.
Okay, that's going to do it for this round of coverage. We will be back shortly with our next matches in our bracket. We thank you for joining us this morning here at the Southland Bowling League. Mike Flanagan and Matt Turek. We'll be back in just a little bit with more coverage here from AMF All-Star Lanes here in a suburb of New Orleans, Louisiana. We'll be right back, everybody.